Welcome again to Midweek Prayer, which includes a talk from St. James with some additions. They seem to sort of fit in as I was preaching it again.
O Lord, open our lips.
And our mouths shall proclaim your praise.
O God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
The Lord's name be praised.
And Psalm 15. Lord, who may dwell in your tabernacle, who may rest upon your holy hill, whoever leads an uncorrupt life and does the thing that is right.
Who speaks the truth from the heart and bears no deceit on the tongue, who does no evil to a friend and pours no scorn on a neighbour.
In whose sight the wicked are not esteemed, but who honours those who fear the Lord. Whoever has sworn to a neighbour and never goes back on that word.
Who does not lend money in hope of gain, nor takes a bribe against the innocent. Whoever does these things shall never fall. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
Soul in death, refresh my
The reading is verses from Mark's Gospel, chapter 7. When the Pharisees and some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem gathered around Jesus, they noticed that some of his disciples were eating with defiled hands, that is, without washing them. For the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they thoroughly wash their hands, thus observing the tradition of the elders. And they do not eat anything from the market unless they wash it. And there are also many other traditions that they observe, the washing of cups, pots, and bronze kettles. So the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not live according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?" Jesus said to them, "Isaiah prophesied rightly about you hypocrites. As it is written, 'This people honours me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines.' You abandon the commandment of God and hold to human tradition." Then he called the crowd again and said to them, "Listen to me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing outside a person that by going in can defile, but the things that come out are what defile. For it is from within, from the human heart, that evil intentions come: fornication, theft, murder, adultery, avarice, wickedness, deceit, licentiousness, envy, slander, pride, folly. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person."
And so we pray. Lord God, may we find ways to continue to be changed and transformed by the life and teaching of Jesus Christ, so that we can live out his love among those we meet, for Jesus' sake. Amen. This is a talk that I wrote for St. James Norton and preached there on Sunday. Religions need to evolve. Times change. In every age, there are new challenges, new problems, new opportunities, as well as inevitable hard choices to be made. So the founding documents of a religion have to be added to, supplemented, as well as checked with the original to make sure that they have not drifted away from that first intent. And of course there will be drift from first intentions. Additions with the best will of them in the world in one generation can cause problems in another, and that's happened in church history. And all this seems to be really quite important in our day, because there is such a rise of fundamentalism. And I think I understand some of the reasons for that. In very simplistic terms, the pace of change, as we all know, is bewildering. And we find comfort and refuge in simple, clear beliefs, whether they be religious or secular. What fascinates me about Christian fundamentalism, which I suppose I know a little bit more about, is that though they claim to go back to the solid core of Bible teaching, they also seem to incorporate what I think Jesus would call traditions of the elders, like original sin, which is actually a construct of the great theologian Saint Augustine of Hippo in the 4th century. And I think he introduced it for good reasons, but we now take it as what the Bible says. But actually, I think we're reading it back into what the Bible says, and we might not necessarily come up with it if we hadn't heard of it. And that seems to be the sort of thing that Jesus is challenging in our gospel reading. He is criticizing the tradition of the elders and saying that in holding to them, the Pharisees are missing the absolutely most fundamental point of faith. And Jesus says that it is not about external cleanliness, or that it isn't external cleanliness that is most important to God, but internal cleanliness. God sees our hearts, and it is the attitudes and motivations of our hearts which count most, which actually gives a different perspective. So if it's the motivations that count, the mistakes we make are just slightly less significant. I mean, they are, because they reinforce, but it is the motivations of our heart, the core of who we are, that needs to be most deeply transformed and healed, because we carry so much pain with us and so much of our failure is rooted in our pain and what's been done to us through our lives. And when we focus on the externals, and it's so easy to do that, we can avoid the uncomfortable depths of who we are and why we do what we do. It's so much easier to control the externals, but not be aware of that need for deep change inside. And that seems to me what Jesus is always taking us back to in the Gospels, in his enigmatic statements. He's taking us back to the heart of things. I think there is a danger in our Gospel reading, because just somehow the way Mark has presented it has given Christians historically the excuse to abandon cleanliness and hygiene, and there was more to that. But if the pandemic has taught us anything, it is the importance of washing our hands. The real genius, I think, of the Christian faith is that we have four independent images of Jesus, well, at least four, because we have yet more in the letters, but four writings that set out to give us this picture of Jesus and his teaching and his life. And for many years, I strove to paper over the cracks between the Gospels and show that they present a coherent view of Jesus. And I still think they do. I am absolutely sure they do give a coherent view of Jesus. But I find myself now far more interested in the differences between the Gospels and what that says about how we are all very different people, which I hope makes me better able to appreciate other people's strengths and weaknesses. Let me give you an example. Matthew's gospel is regarded as the greatest gospel. That's why it comes first in the Bible. Not that it was written first, probably. And Matthew's collection and organisation of Jesus' teaching is brilliant. But he is a bit pushy, shall we say. He is responsible for most of the bits in the Gospel, not all, but most of the bits, which go something like this. And they will be cast into outer darkness, where there will be wailing and gnashing of teeth, and variations on that theme. And I understand that it is necessary to have that sort of encouragement to make decisions about Jesus at certain times in history and at certain stages in faith. But I just have to say that I find that sort of language really quite difficult at the moment, where I am at the moment. But in all of this, the challenge for me is, how do we keep in touch with the core of the life and teaching of Jesus and allow that life and teaching to continue to change us little by little, day by day, week by week, making us more like Jesus in the way we respond to the people we meet? And that, you know, that goes back to sort of seeing the differences of the gospel writers. And if we're using Bible reading notes, what are the sort of strengths and weaknesses, prejudices of the people who are writing those notes? Are they wanting to keep us into a very simplistic view of faith? Or are they opening up a bigger, more challenging, perhaps more difficult understanding of faith that really stretches us and makes us think? It is so easy to focus on the externals and avoid the uncomfortable core of who we are with God, what God is really saying to us and leading us on to. So how can we do that? How can we meet with and engage with the person of Jesus and what he said in a way that is right for us as individuals and at the stage we're at in our journey with God? You probably don't need to say that some sort of regular rendezvous with God, time set aside with God, reading the Bible, perhaps using some sort of help to help us think about things and maybe give us some explanation. All these seem really important, and a way of praying what we read to let God speak more deeply into our hearts, to ponder a passage. And there are all sorts of ways of doing that, and you have to find the way that is right for you. But if things are going a bit dry at the moment, maybe try something different. There's lots of stuff online, there's free stuff, I think good free stuff, but you have to be choosy. Maybe try something different and have a word with me if you can, or email me and say, well, this is where I'm at and what might be helpful. Because it's just so important that we keep engaging with Jesus and what he taught, because that, to me, is the heart of what it is to be a Christian.
Help me to be willing to let you have your way, Jesus. You are changing me as I let you reign supreme within my heart. Jesus, you are changing me by your Spirit, you're making me like you. Oh, Jesus, you're transforming me. That your loveliness may be seen in all I do. Oh, you are the potter, and I am the clay. Help me to be willing to let you have your way, Jesus. You are changing me as I let you reign supreme within my
Almighty God, you search us and know us. May we rely on you in strength and rest on you in weakness, now and in all our days, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. God of love, who alone brings growth to your church, send your Holy Spirit to give vision to our planning, compassion in our recovery, wisdom to our actions, and power to our witness. Help our churches to grow in numbers, in spiritual commitment to you, and in service to our local community. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
O gracious and holy Father, give us wisdom to perceive you, diligence to seek you, patience to wait for you, eyes to behold you, a heart to meditate upon you, and a life to proclaim you, through the power of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Lord, help us as we think about how we engage with Jesus day by day, week by week, so that we may be changed and transformed from the core of who we are. Help us to think about our times with you and how we might go on in them, what resources we might need, what different approaches we might take, so that we can be transformed into the people you want us to be and able to share your love as you long to see us do. For Jesus' sake. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
And so may God inspire you to make the most of your daily rendezvous with God. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. And thanks for watching.